There is no one better in the country to put in context what we've been discussing today, and also no one better in the country to remind us that we have jobs and we have responsibilities. And the latter, at certain times, must override the former. So Dale, great pleasure to be with you.
Because after 30 years of running up and down stairs in power plants, my knees don't work as good as they should. This up and give you the big picture. And I will say this, I have not prepared any detailed presentation, and I didn't figure that I needed to because I knew Dan had his mind wrapped completely around and Nora with the facts and figures about San Onofre. I was given the opportunity. Dan asked me to review the report before it was issued to the NRC, which I did. And I can only say I am incredibly impressed with the amount of work that these guys did. The incredible amount of data that Dora went through, Dan went through, and how they get their facts straight and present it very clearly as he's done here. I've known Dan for, what, maybe almost 40 years. And starting from in 1976 when I left GE. And Dan has just kept on consistently going after this very serious problem that we face in this country and in the world. And I can only say that I appreciate the fact that there are people like Dan who are out there continuing to do this kind of work. I had retired about 7 or 8 years ago and figured I wasn't going to have to do anything more. And then Fukushima came along. When Fukushima came along, all of a sudden the phone started ringing and my name apparently had drifted to the top of the pile because of the work that I had done back in 1976 and later years with Mark I containments, as Dan has spoken. The thing that I guess I wanted to talk about mostly is this issue of the regulatory problems. How do you get the regulatory authorities to do the real job that they are supposed to do? I hate to just say, talk about negative things, but there are not a whole lot of positive things to talk about. So I guess that's an apology, but that's the way it is. Back when I first started in the nuclear business a long time ago, about 50 years ago or so, in the United States, the nuclear programs were regulated by what was called at that time the Atomic Energy Commission. The Atomic Energy Commission had two jobs. One was to regulate safety, and the other one was to promote the use of nuclear power. You laugh, and of course that's the usual reaction because, you know, how can you do both of these independently without a lot of without bias one way or the other? Now, when I was about in 1970-72, something like that, it became obvious that this was a problem, U.S. government decided that they were going to separate regulation from promotion. So they left the Atomic Energy Commission as it existed, more or less, and they split off the regulatory authority into the Nuclear Regulatory Commission. The problem was, of course, they didn't change any people. They just moved people's titles and reporting chains of command. Now, when I was working at GE, I had, I'll say, the opportunity. I really enjoyed my work. And I did quite a bit of work with the Japanese utilities. I did some work on Fukushima. I did some work on Suruga in Japan and a couple of other plants. And in the early days back then, in about 1970, the Japanese regulatory authority was fell under the auspices of an organization called MITI, M-I-T-I, and I don't remember what it stood for, but it was sort of like the NRC. And then it devolved into NISA, the Nuclear Safety Agency, and now just this year, they have made another change. They have now split the regulatory authority in Japan off to another organization. But the problem, I'm sure, is going to be just like we had in this country, and that is, you got the same damn people doing the same thing. And it doesn't really change the way they do the work. It doesn't change their mindsets. As Dan indicated, I left GE back in 1976 because at that time I had been given a special assignment, which was to manage the reevaluation of the Mark I containment designs. I'm not going to go into a lot of details on it, but the problem was the system had not been designed to withstand the accident that it was supposed to contain. And we had some 16 plants already in operation in the United States, another 10 or so around the world when we became aware of that problem. Well, what would you do if you knew that you had, as Dan used the metaphor, you got the car without brakes going down the road? You either really slow down or you stop it. Well, of course, in the nuclear world, you don't do that. If you acknowledge that you have a serious safety problem, you run the risk of shutting the whole industry down and ruining your business opportunities. So, of course, the pressure was on to keep things running while we did about a five-year analytical program to determine whether they were safe, weren't safe, were safe enough, needed to be modified, or what. And I'm going to just give you one little story that I remember about the 1st of January in 1976. I had arranged to go to a review meeting with the Nuclear Regulatory Commission back in Washington, D.C. And you know how most of the government meetings are, you have this rule that, you know, everything has to be done with transparency, you know, the Sunshine Act and so on. Well, when we showed up in Washington, we, of course, went out to dinner with the NRC the night before. We went back to their offices. We told the NRC people that we had some serious problems and that we needed to really seriously think about what to do with these plants that were in operation. In reply, we got from the main guy at NRC, who was responsible for reviewing this stuff, he gave us a one-hour chalk talk on the blackboard explaining to us why this could not be a problem. Right? This was the regulatory authority. So that gives you a feeling for the mindset. Okay, now the thing that I would just say about Fukushima, I have a few facts. I Googled the Fukushima recovery plan this afternoon. I've been following it pretty closely for about a year, but things, the flow of information has sort of slowed down now. They're in the middle, you know, they're slogging around along trying to figure out what to do with the thing. But there are some interesting things I can tell you about Fukushima. Fukushima Daiichi plant consists of six units, all of them in Mark I containments. TEPCO, the operator of the plant, has decided that they're not going to attempt to return any of those plants to service. They can, of course, because they're melted down. But they have decided that they're going to terminate operation of all six of those plants. Two of them perhaps could have been put back in service. They have another plant, Daini, which has got four more units, and they're considering not starting those up either. I just want to give you some numbers here. In 10 years of last year, a start should be made with the retrieval of melted fuel of the reactors. Okay, they're going to start to remove the melted fuel in 10 years. But before they do that, they have to repair the containments on all of those plants because there's so much radioactivity and so much stuff that they've got to deal with. They've got to make sure that the containment will in fact contain the cleanup operation. So, decommissioning would take more than 30 years because the pressure vessels of the reactor vessels are damaged and filled with melted fuel and so on. And then they go on to say that the overall cleanup program would take 30 years, perhaps, if they did their cost estimates properly. And it's going to cost them in the neighborhood of $405 billion. Okay. If you don't know what a yen is, it takes about 80 of them to make a dollar. So they're talking about $50 to $60 billion to just clean up the mess. Yeah. Well, PG&E built Diablo Canyon for about $5 billion apiece. So what that really says is to clean up the mess of Fukushima will cost what it took to build two or three Diablo Canyons. So the bottom line is that nuclear power, as David Brower said, is a good way to find an earthquake fault. It's also a very expensive way to boil water. It is a very demanding and very difficult technology because just one little mistake can really, as they say, one nuclear bomb can ruin your whole day. So that's about the extent of my comments. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have, if you have anything. I guess I should say this. There are no Mark I containments in the state of California, so you don't have to worry about them here. There are no boiling water reactors west of Iowa, so there are no BWR containments that you have to worry about. Well, that's not quite right. There's one in Washington State. But I think the thing that we need to worry about here is we need to take a look at the Diablo Canyon from a seismic standpoint. So with that, if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer. The containment very soon. Well, it means, I guess it's very obvious, it means, A, maybe it's not possible, or is going to be extremely expensive. Now, I've read recently there's been some renewed discussion in Japan about the use of a sarcophagus approach to Fukushima. Now that, for those of you who have followed the Chernobyl accident, you know that that's what they did there. They basically buried it in concrete and lead and did not attempt to clean it up. And so there is a possibility that they may have to go that way in Japan at Fukushima. I get a report about every 2 weeks from Japan, and you know, they're